Hi, welcome back to The Shtick, where this time around, back in my living room, after being at C31 control room, we've got in my very comfortable living room.
It's a beautifully appointed living room, lots of camels.
Thank you, Jacqueline. We've got Jacqueline Pascarl here in her full bloom. You're looking gorgeous, as usual.
Oh, you wouldn't want to see me half an hour ago.
Tracky dag.
Yeah, absolutely. Full COVID attire.
Were you locked down through the lockdown?
Yep.
Altogether?
Yep, very much so.
We're suddenly, like, you're the second guest I've had in who's actually been in person with a safe distance, 2 metres.
Exactly. I'm thinking, oh, distance. Yeah, no. That'll be all right. I'll mic myself up.
Well, I have to introduce you to our viewers, but I think you're pretty well known, and in some sense you're famous, and in the other sense nobody's ever heard of you. You've got this double life.
It's so good.
And it's very interesting, because I was following your career, or I don't know what it's called. It's your journey, isn't it? You've had a journey, but we won't go into that. If anybody wants to look you up, you've got a website.
Yeah, there's a website. Go to LinkedIn. Look me up on LinkedIn.
You know? Don't believe Wikipedia.
No, not at all.
Fake news. But you've had an amazing past, and now you're back in Melbourne. You were originally from Melbourne.
Absolutely. Born and bred in Melbourne. Raised partly in Gippsland on a dairy farm, and then schooled back here in Melbourne.
Right, and in the meantime, you married a Malaysian sultan, or whatever he was. He was a
grandson of the King of Malaysia.
So right, so what was his title? He had a title, Raj or something.
Yes, Raja Bahrin.
That's it. Yeah. And he had two children with you, or you had two children with him?
I did.
Yeah,
I did. And you know, that was a long time ago. My eldest is, you know, I'm that was 37 years ago, so it
really?
Is a long time ago, a long time, or maybe
you were
longer.
17 when you
I was
married.
17, yeah, maybe yeah. longer.
Okay, so. And so you've had this amazing journey, and now you're back in Melbourne on another journey
yep.
where you're working in Operation Angel. Tell us a little bit about
that's
that.
That's right. Well, I've never really left Melbourne. I lived overseas for periods of time, but I was like a homing bird, always come home.
Mm.
And in 1997, I established Operation Angel, which is a not-for-profit humanitarian relief agency. And we try to work strategically and very adaptably on the ground. It started as a women's hygiene project
mm-hmm.
and then evolved into helping Australian and our region during times of natural disaster or emergency. So we've just come off the back of the bushfires
mm-hmm.
and during that period of time we were doing hygiene kits for evacuees, and then rolled immediately into the need to provide humanitarian relief kits for first responders, primarily firefighters. And those packs were prepared and collated and stripped down of all detritus and anything flammable by these amazing teams. Hundreds and hundreds of volunteers every day came to work. We had the Israeli dance group. We had a yeshiva college come in. We had community groups from the Jewish communities come in because, you know, I'm the Jewish girl raised by Gentiles, quite literally.
Yeah.
My grandmother and my mother are Jewish. But aside from that, we had members of the Sikh community, we had kids from private schools come in, we had the gamut, and we worked on that all the way up until the COVID outbreak, and then we went into hiatus.
You started actually working in the bushfires in Queensland in the Black Saturday?
We did Black Saturday in Victoria.
Yeah.
Because initially I was doing airlifts of hygiene products to Bosnia and Kosovo during mm-hmm. the wars there in the 90s.
Yeah, and you
East
also
Timor.
Had a whole scene in Africa as well.
Yeah, I did that, and there was a whole lot of stuff. So, but during Black Saturday I worked driving trucks up to King Lake and Marysville. And then in 2011 with Cyclone Yasi and the major floods that Queensland had, Operation
right,
Angel
as well.
Became the single largest donor mm-hmm. of material aid to the state of Queensland. Just by making phone calls.
And now you're working with the Army in some way.
Well, actually, Army, Navy and Air Force for 5 years, and I've just finished off that statutory appointee. I was the first legislated statutory appointee as a female into the role of National Vice Chair of the Australian Defence Force, in charge of reserves and interface with corporate Australia. So I did that for 5 years, Army, Navy and Air Force, and it was the best thing I have ever done. I love doing that. I just adored meeting our service men and women, working in that field and getting to know the logistics, because it came off the back of me being humanitarian liaison for NATO during the wars in the Balkans. So I had a bit of time under my belt working. I speak fluent Army.
And there you also met Major General Professor Dr. Jeffrey Rosenfeld.
Ah, the great Jeffrey Rosenfeld. He is incredible. He's not just a skilled clinician and physician. He's an amazing musician, but most of all, he's a mensch.
Yep.
And I love him to pieces.
All about the mensch. And he was in our first segment where we talked about free speech.
Yes.
And you're just about to go on radio, on ABC radio, to talk about racism. Because we've been surrounded now by this sudden rioting and controversy in America about what to do, how to stop people from that. How are we going to stop racism?
Well, yeah, I'll give you the potted answer and solve the world's problems.
Yeah, I know.
Look, I think that when we talk about racism in Australia, we lack a sophisticated discourse and conversation. We don't like a mirror being held up to ourselves. I don't think Australia is vitriolically and consciously racist. I think that we devolve into labels and to trying to place someone desperately, and what can seem to the inquirer as curiosity can actually become quite insulting and quite a negative experience for those being probed, so to speak, aside from Aboriginal deaths in custody and the appalling conditions that
not
that
not to mention
to,
the Aboriginal deaths in custody.
That's right.
Yeah, because we haven't really, it's only been brought up since George Floyd died, that this has suddenly come up and everything's conflagrated.
Yeah, but in terms of racism, I mean, I'm French, Jewish, Irish, English, and I happen to have a little bit of Chinese in me as well.
Yeah.
So growing up in the late 60s as a small child in Australia, sticks, stones, literally mud, rotten plums, chants in the playground, people being moved away from me. I didn't understand. My grandmother, you know, was this beautiful Jewish French woman with red hair and green eyes, and my mum was a white blonde. And then most of the time when I was tiny, I was raised on a farm way away from the city. I didn't know what they were talking about. It was quite a shock to me.
You got the old Ching Chong label.
All of that distasteful stuff.
Because you still look Eurasian. That's where your beauty comes from. I usually find that when you mix Asian and European, you get the most gorgeous mix.
Well, I just like to say that I've always identified just as a human being. And I still have questions thrown at me that become quite distressing. Over many, many years, about once a fortnight.
Really?
Someone will say, where are you from? Okay, Australia.
Yeah.
And then they say, oh, yeah, but where are you really from? Melbourne? Yeah, but, you know, where are you from? Where are your people from? Gippsland? On a farm? And it gets to the point where I just refuse to tell them. I refuse to say it. But they stand there in front of you with this grin, but they're getting frustrated, wanting to know, wanting to push.
Because and I you say, look exotic. You've got the exotic look.
Well, yeah, but lots of people look exotic now, although when I was growing up, people didn't.
No.
But I'll say, yes, okay, so I'll say Irish, English, French, Jewish, and then I stop. And they say, but yeah, but the rest, haven't you got some Asian in you somewhere? Until I actually capitulate and say it. But it always makes me feel very uncomfortable.
And your father was Chinese?
Yeah.
He was?
Yeah, he was. But I was raised here and I don't speak a word of Chinese. I speak 8 languages, but not one of them is Chinese.
Yeah, well, we have so much more to discuss. I'm going to invite you back for more shtick, for sure. When we're not so rushed and you don't have to be on radio.
But, you know, I've just got to say, with the Operation Angel now, I've just been dealing with Naot. The Israeli-Australian beautiful footwear company, and they just gave me $500,000 worth of beautiful shoes for the bushfire victims. And we got them up there within 24 hours, distributed. No hanging on to it. We don't deal cash.
Yeah, because COVID came along immediately after the bushfires were, you know, just ending, and then we got COVID. Now we've got this riot in America, and it's very easy for us to forget. But there is a bushfire inquiry now, isn't there?
There's a royal commission. There is indeed. And I think that people will be shocked to know that although the inquiry is going on, we have people in the Alpine region and throughout East Gippsland living in tents in the snow because the aid hasn't got to them. The finances that were donated haven't been distributed to them. And of course, with COVID, naturally, and that's fine, people had to withdraw their welfare workers. So we've tried to step in to fill the void with warm clothing and decent shoes, giving people a gift of dignity, not a handout of charity.
Well, you are a true humanitarian. I know you've won many awards and you deserve even more the way you're working at the moment. And the PTSD work that you're doing now, you just told us about StKilda Road.
Yes.
What's that?
Well, I'm on the board of directors of ANVAM, the Australian National Veterans Art Museum.
Right.
And we are about to take over 310 at StKilda Road, which is a derelict building. Mm-hmm. And we work through arts therapy for veterans and also first responders. And we deal with their families as well. And we give them a creative outlet and a channel for their trauma to create rather than destroy, to uplift rather than downplay the extent of what they see unfolding before their eyes in most horrific situations and moments of sacrifice and bravery. So we work with entire families because we want to keep boots under tables, not 6 feet under.
Correct. Well, I think every cause you've ever been involved in has had such profound needs that you've come along and filled those needs. So I take my hat off to you, madam, which I never do on TV. But it's been so lovely to have you on the Shtick, Jacqueline.
It's been a pleasure to come in here, and it's a hoot, and I love your show.
Yeah, I love
what you do, because I think that open dialogue and discussion, far-ranging, is the way that we bring the world forward.
And one other thing I need to talk to you about, and I want to get a comment from you, is Channel 31's closure. What do you think is the reason that the government would have to close community television?
Short-sightedness, stupidity. It's appalling because community television is where many of the greats that we now love on television began. Rove McManus started there. And Rove went on to produce not only his own shows but The Project Every Night. Yep. So those, the powers that be, if you are thinking of continuing to withdraw funding from Channel 31, it's short-sighted, it's ridiculous, and this is the feeding ground and the growing up ground for many of our terrific talents. And it would be a tragedy if that happened.
Jacqueline, I really admire your work, admire you personally, and I'm inviting you to come back again for a full shtick.
I want to do the
full frontal with you, darling. And thanks very much for coming on. And we'll be back next week with more shtick because it just never ends. Shalom.
Shalom.